Good morning, I'm Katie Ralston, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to Unity Bay Area Houston Sunday Celebration. We are so happy that you've joined us today. So today, together, let's say today's affirmation. Ready? I bless myself when I let go and let God. Thank you for helping us keep a fragrance-free sanctuary. It helps everyone's sinuses and supports your ability to serve. Now, please share our Sunday services and events through your social media of choice. And please share the love that you receive and keep the love going. So, ready for a song?
You bet.
All right.
Everybody stand up, sing with me.
Let us begin our service together as we affirm our statement of truth. There is one presence and one power in the universe and in me, God the good, omnipotence. Prayer is the basis on which Unity was founded. Our prayer chaplains pray for you and your request for 30 days. Your prayers are also sent to Silent Unity to be prayed for at the same time. That's double prayer power. We have prayer request forms in the back. And then today, Sarah Thompson. Sarah, raise your hand, please. There's Sarah. And Ellen Rogers. Where's Ellen? There's Ellen right back there, okay. Well, today, Sarah and Ellen's and John V. Raise your hand, please. Okay, there we go. They're our prayer chaplains for today, for those of you who would like to pray in person. And for our digital viewers, or if you have a prayer request, please click the button that says Request Prayer in your bulletin, or you can leave a private message through Facebook Messenger. Now, Sarah and John V will lead a prayer circle in the front following today's service. And in the prayer circle, we say the name of anything or anyone that's on our heart and that we want to lift in prayer. Ellen will be offering one-on-one prayer there in the back. So please join as you feel called. And now please join Reverend Howard in prayer.
Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Peace be with you, and just invite you to turn within in the way that you are most comfortable. Dear God, infinite spirit, as we gather here together as a community and spiritual family, may your presence be felt oh so deeply. May we be led to walk in the paths of peacefulness, inner harmony, well-being. May we live from the heart of your love and open our hearts to life itself. May we open to your renewing strength, feel your healing power in all areas of our life, be guided to live the truth that sets us all free. And we go now in complete openness and surrender to oneness with you. And this we pray in Christ's nature. And so it is. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Howard. Okay, time for some announcements. This week's announcements and all leaks to participate can be found in your Sunday e-bulletin, which was sent out this morning at 7 a.m. And for our in-person folks today, please visit the connection table to show your interest. We have the connection table inside today. It's over there again. So, oh, well, what's this one over here for? Something else. Okay, it's in the foyer today. All right, where are we? Oh. Access to our updated newsletters and bulletins are easily found on our new website, www.unitybayareahouston.org, by clicking on the orange newsletter button at the top of the page, or you may call 281-554-2450 and leave a message requesting event details. So here's some of the things we have coming up. The Unity Women's Ministry and Potluck will be held in the gathering room this Tuesday at 6 p.m. Please bring a dish to share and enjoy connective spiritual discussion. And the Unity Men's Dinner Group will meet again at King's Beer House on Highway 646 in Lake City at 6:30. That's also this Tuesday on August 2nd. Have you taken Prosperity Plus classes? Returning students are welcome. Now's the time to recharge your prosperity consciousness and reconnect to divine abundance. If you have experienced the energy of Prosperity Plus 1, 2, or 3 and want to reboot your life, RSVP to attend the original Prosperity Plus, a new way of living to be taught by Rob Pell, there's Rob, on Wednesdays at 7 p.m., and that'll be beginning on August 10th. Reverend Kira's Silver Celestial Celebration is Saturday, yes, woohoo, Saturday, August 13th from 2 to 5. Let's gather around our minister to show our love and appreciation. Planning teams will begin meeting again next week. If you're interested in joining the party planning, please contact Ellen Rogers at events@unitybayareahouston.org. Now we have a video, right, for the prayer chaplains.
Oh, good morning, prayer chaplains. We're so blessed to have each and every one of you here. And so, what we wanted to do was talk a little bit about the prayer chaplain program and what do you feel made you want to become a prayer chaplain. And we'll start here with Domingo. And Domingo, also tell us as we go through how long you've been a prayer chaplain.
I've been a prayer chaplain for 2 years now. For 2 years I have been a prayer chaplain. And basically I joined because I felt I was making one of the ways that I can make a contribution to others, as well as joining a team of very committed, caring, loving individuals.
My name is John V. Jariwala. I've been a prayer chaplain for 1 year, and the reason that I'm a prayer chaplain is because I feel that my extension with Unity Worldwide Ministries for 2 decades and being certified as a oneness blessing with Reverend Kira to continue the path of being a prayer chaplain to interact with the individuals that are gifts and talents and they're facing challenges and obstacles, that I feel that I can bless them in their path. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dawn Pence. I've been a prayer chaplain for 1 year, and I wanted to become a prayer chaplain because I felt that I had a great connection, one-on-one prayer with God, but I wanted to be able to give that to others, to learn how to share affirmative prayer so that others could learn to do that with others and with themselves.
My name is Sarah Thompson. I became a prayer chaplain to connect with people. People that were in need and wanted to be prayed with. And so I felt that it was a very strong calling for me in my prayer life to do this work.
My name is Wendy Hoggett, and I've been a prayer chaplain for 6 years. I became a prayer chaplain to deepen my connection with Spirit and to share it with others.
My name is Phoenix Blanton, and I've been a youth prayer chaplain for 1 year, and I became a youth prayer chaplain because to give back to my church, because I've been here since I've been a baby, and I've found a lot of peace with it, and I just love being a prayer chaplain.
Yes, hi, my name is Eugenia, and I've been a prayer chaplain for 4 years, ever since we actually started to join this church. And why did I do it? I did it because I have an innate desire to connect to with people and to actually learn as well the new way to pray, which is manifestation. So anytime I meet with someone who wants prayer, I let them discover God in them, and having that connection, human, God, and the Spirit, we can pray better. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Roger Moorfield. I've been a prayer chaplain 4 years, and I wanted, when we started at Unity, Eugenia and I, we realized that the Unity way of praying was so different than the way we'd been praying most of our lives, and we wanted to learn more about this affirmative prayer. And so becoming a prayer chaplain and taking the training was a way to do that. And of course, then continuing as a prayer chaplain would be a way to practice that. Of course, the benefit that I received from being a prayer chaplain is that this community is just loving, caring, just supportive, so very, very much so. And it's another way of serving this community, which is so affirming to me, just the way that I can serve.
Can we just give a round of applause to our prayer chaplains? Just thank you, those of you who are prayer chaplains here. Thank you so much for that service for us. It's like having a friend you can pray with, right? Well, we are friends here. You will be if you haven't been here for a while. You'll make friends, I promise. Okay, so are you called to pray? Because now's the time to center in and prayerfully consider, am I ready to take the next step in my spiritual journey by becoming a prayer chaplain? Is this still on? Can you hear okay? Okay. Reverend Kira will be offering the training to set you up for success August 19th and 20th. If your heart is ready, join us for this opportunity to learn about and experience Unity Prayer in your life as a prayer chaplain. This workshop is open to the congregation, but it's specifically for renewing and new prayer chaplains. So that's a required continuing ed for the prayer chaplains. But feel free to come if you want to learn more about praying and praying in the Unity way. Now, please join me for our vision, mission, values, and affirmation. Our vision is a world powerfully transformed through the growing movement of a shared spiritual awakening. Our mission is to inspire minds, awaken hearts, and empower lives through the teachings of Jesus Christ and other expressions of universal truth. In all that we are and all that we live, we value unconditional love, connection, authenticity, inclusivity, trust, and compassion. We are living relevant spirituality now.
Okay, stand up again. Let's make love our decision.
Inside.
Thank you, Patty. Your presence here today is precious to us all. Thank you for joining us this morning. We're excited that some folks are joining us for the first time. And if you'd like more information about our community and Unity Teachings, you may connect with a greeter after the service. Domingo, you're a greeter today, right? Yes, Domingo will. Oh, and also Maria, hands up. Do we have anybody here who's here for the first time? First time? No? Well, online viewers, you may connect with us through Messenger on our Facebook page. If you're looking for a spiritual place to be renewed and lifted, we would love to welcome you. So we don't have any first timers here, huh? But are there any people who've been here for the third time? Third time? Well, we all know about the fourth and fifth and sixth and seventh and eighth time, so. Well, if you're new or a repeat visitor, we have a unique Unity gift to thank you. So if you haven't gotten that before, please see the greeters afterwards and they will share that with you. So we're going to share our Unity blessing, our welcome blessing for those of us who are here often, and also for anyone who's new out there watching on Facebook Live. So together, let's share our blessing. We love you, we bless you, we appreciate you, and we behold the Christ in you. Now we'll center in to receive today's daily word with John V.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our word today is let go, let God. Our affirmation, I bless myself when I let go and let God. If I find myself ruminating over a concern or a weighty decision, I release its grip on my attention by letting go and letting God. When I let go, I am placing my trust in the divine mind, a source of infinite potential. I believe there are solutions and remedies of which I'm limited by human mind simply cannot conceive. When I let God, I am trusting the grace God will bless my life in the most wondrous and even surprising ways. Letting go and letting God is how I live my faith. I surrender to spiritual truth, the presence and power of God, and I believe the best outcome is going to be so much better than anything I can imagine. And I affirm, I let go and let God, and I relax into knowing I'm deeply loved and abundantly blessed. And John chapter 14, verse 1, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me.
When I pray, I feel my heart go deeper, my heart go deeper into my God. When I pray, I feel my heart go deeper, my heart go deeper into my God.
And so I just invite you to allow the words of that song to take you into that quiet inner sanctuary of your being, where you feel your deepest connection to the very source of life, love, goodness that fills the earth, the cosmos, fills your very being. So if you haven't already done so, I just invite you to close your eyes. And I take a deep breath. I release. And I affirm that I do really, fully now let go. Let go of all the cares and concerns I may have been carrying. I set myself free. I allow an awareness of the very presence of God to be felt within me throughout my being. Just allow your feeling nature to take on that sense of oneness. Divine energies are here. They're flowing freely in body and mind and soul. And I am now centered in my oneness with Spirit. And here I am given the strength and the will to keep on keeping on. It is here that I'm centered in Spirit with the strength, the wisdom, the guidance to handle all the affairs of my life. Be given the ability to make right and good decisions. And right here, this moment, centered in God, I have the ability and the courage to let go fully of the past, to move forward in newness, to create the fullness of life. It is here that I have the faith to know there really is no loss, no separation in God. That in Him, I am forever one with all those who I love. And it's here, centered in God, and I'm given the vision to see the good in all things, to see the Christ in all persons, to feel connected to all life, all people, all nature, all that is. It is here, centered in God, that I meet each and every experience with a deep knowing that truly all things are working together for good. It is here that I know that I'm being loved fully right now, for God is love, and that love surrounds and enfolds me and embraces me. And I am so very grateful for these truths and this deep knowing. And so it is. And now as you come back, if you would join me in saying the words of our Lord's Prayer, which are on the screen. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Stop.
things look so bad everywhere. In this whole world, what is fair? We walk the line and we try to see, falling behind in what will be.
Thank you. Each and every one of us knows something amazing is about to take place. Reverend Howard Caesar is here with us. Please, one more big round of applause. And before he comes to tell us all about the spiritual Highlands, I just want to mention and put a word in your ear to hold in prayerful consideration. Howard is having a workshop September 30th through October 2nd at Camp Allen. Has anyone ever been to Camp Allen? Camp Allen is amazing, and to have a workshop with Reverend Howard is just a fabulous experience. If you'd like to know more about that, I'm sure he'll give us more information. All you have to do is put your name and phone number or email in the back if you would like to learn more about that. Thank you so much, Reverend Howard.
Thank you, thank you. Am I on? Can you hear me? I am. No, I'm not.
Not loud.
Oh. This?
No, sir.
I think this one we're going to turn on. There we go. There we go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Ellen. Thank you, Patty. And the workshop, or the actually 3-day retreat, is called The Spiritually Awakened Life. And so there will be lots of teachings and also meditations to integrate what we teach. So that's that. So good morning, everyone, again. Good to be with you. I think the last time I was here with you was Palm Sunday, actually. And we had a good time then, and hope to this morning as well, and that I can share something that will be meaningful and powerful for you as well. I just want to bless our dear one, Kira. She is doing well. I had lunch with her recently, and I bless her on her 25 years. I wanted to celebrate that with her a little bit in private, And congratulate her. 25 years is not easy for any minister to make, because it is a 24/7 commitment. And so we bless her, and I thank her for giving me the opportunity to be with you here this morning. I would like to start out with something that a little bit humorous. Did you hear that there is a new store that opened some time ago in New York City? Yeah, it's a store. It's called the Husband Store, and you can go there and shop for a husband. Yes, yes, and there are actually 6 floors to this store, and you can only visit each floor one time. So if you go up a floor, you can't go back. All right. So and the value of that which you're shopping for increases as you go up. And so, but you cannot go down. So this lady, there's a woman that went shopping for her husband at this store. And she went to the first floor, and when you get to the floor, there's a sign and tells you a little bit about what the product is. And the sign said, these men have jobs. She decided to go to the second floor. And the sign when she got to the second floor said, these men have jobs and love kids. And then she kept going, went to the third floor, and said, these men have jobs, love kids, and are good looking. She thought, wow, this is really pretty good, but I'm compelled to go on, you know, knowing I can't go back down. So she goes to the fourth floor, and the sign reads, these men have jobs, love kids, are drop-dead good looking, and help with housework. She thought, oh, mercy me, I can hardly stand it. Still, I have to go on. She went to the fifth floor. And the sign there said, these men have jobs, love kids, are drop-dead gorgeous, help with the housework, and have a very strong romantic streak. Wow, she thought, this is tremendous, but she couldn't stand it. She had to go to the sixth and top floor. When she got to the sixth floor, there was a sign there that said, you are visitor number 31,466, and there are no men on this floor. This floor exists solely as proof that women are impossible to please. I suppose the men would like that, and I don't like to pick on the women, but actually I heard this story from a woman, so that makes it a little safe. And also, if there was a store where there were wives you could go by, I think the same scenario would unfold. But joke aside, you know, the point that I want to be making is really we always want to go higher. You know, we always want life to be better. We always want greater good. We always want the energies that are of a higher frequency and vibration, so it's very natural to want to go up. Okay, and to keep going up. And so there is no sense of guilt around that, all right? And so I was looking for a story that would sort of share that and add a little humor as well. But if we are really applying the spiritual principles to this, you know, the story really would have a different ending, because you can never climb to higher levels of consciousness and come up empty, all right? That there will always be a reward, there will always be benefits. You see, any time that we are moving, which is the purpose of life, is to learn and to grow and to evolve and to continue to really raise the frequency and vibration by which we are living, so that we become radiant beings of light. That's what we are anyway, and it's awakening to that, is it not? And so as you seek to do that, there will always be the reward of living from that higher frequency and being above it all, in a sense. I think it's safe to assume that everyone here has had a special spiritual moment in their life. You know, one that was holy and sacred, one where they felt deeply connected, one that was just out of the ordinary daily life, where they felt touched by God. You know, and it might have been even a mystical experience. It might have been a turning point in their life that you can go to. Some of you may be thinking of that even right now. And hopefully we all have had more than just one moment like that. I feel blessed. I can think of more than one that I have had, and they come to mind very quickly because they were of a higher nature that impacted me, and I am forever grateful. And I like to return to those from time to time to remind myself and re-experience that that's who I am, and that's what life is, and those energies exist. The 91st Psalm has that line in it about a dwelling place, dwelling in the secret place of the Most High, right? And we all want to be at a high place, dwelling in that place in consciousness where we are one with the Most High God. It's spelled out, it's inspired in the scriptures, and we should take heed. I call that spiritual highlands, to be in the spiritual highlands, okay? And it's deeply, deeply feeling the spiritual energies of the presence. Now, last month I was in Peru, and I was leading a pilgrimage, a nice group of people, an 11-day pilgrimage to Peru and all of the amazing sights there. Peru is a very, very spiritual place. I've been taking people on pilgrimages for 10 years, over a decade, and this is one of, if not the most, spiritual energy that I have felt the whole time I was there. But there were certain moments that were even up, like peaks. Anyway, while I was there, Ellen Rogers, your wonderful person who works for you and with Kira, she texted me, and she didn't know I was in Peru, and she said, do you have a title for your upcoming talk, which was a few weeks away? And so being in Peru and feeling all these high energies, immediately the title came to me, Spiritual Highlands. And so I sent that. And then about a week after I got back, she asked me, well, do you have certain service slides that you would like to show? Because here, there's a sequence of slides that you all like to have. So I'd like to go over that. And being where I was, I couldn't think of anything other than being back home to send her a few slides and photographs of myself in Peru. And actually, the picture that's on the screen is where I am up on a cliff high above Lake Titicaca. And Lake Titicaca itself, which is a huge body of water, is at 13,500 feet. So the breath is, the air is thin, but it is exhilarating. And we were there and experienced a magnificent sunset from that place with the group. And there's a special moment I really want to share with you that singles out Machu Picchu. And so if we could have that second photo up, there I am and being embraced by a beautiful Machu Picchu. And I know some of you have been there. It's an Inca, for those of you who haven't, it's an Incan citadel that is high in the Andes Mountains. And it's was built in the 15th century. And the walls of the buildings, some of them still remain, and it's beautiful, even though they are seem to be just the residue of what remains. But this was built in astronomical alignment, and specifically to have panoramic views, because the Inca understood that in order to have a life of meaning, basically, all parts of life were important to be in harmony with. To be in harmony with not only the people you're surrounded with, but with the earth, with the cosmos. They were very much into the light and positioning themselves for the light. And that the light even of the sun and what have you represented God coming through. And that there was an emphasis on this intrinsic relationship between them and the earth and the cosmos. And that it was all alive, it was all speaking to them, it was all embracing them. It was like at any point you could open to a portal of experiencing the high energies of the light. And it was a beautiful thing to study and learn about the Incas. Well, so we visited Machu Picchu twice. There were many, many places and highlights and sites that we saw, like where the sunset was and what have you. But Machu Picchu was very special. Any of you who've been there,
It is fabulous. It's jaw-dropping beautiful, and the energies there are intense. They're big. I mean, I've been to Sedona and all the vortexes, but this was over and beyond for me and my experience. So we went there twice because they have a block of about 4 hours. And so we went in the afternoon, and then the next day we went at sunrise. And so wanted to see the sun come up over the mountains of Machu Picchu and have a powerful meditative kind of experience there. The first day was jaw-dropping by itself, but the second day, I was impacted even the greatest. And just to tell you a little bit about that, in the morning you get up and the town down below Machu Picchu is where you're at the hotel and what have you. You get on a bus, and the bus then takes you up to the entrance. It's about a 35-minute drive and climb, so you're going pretty high there. And then once you get there to the entrance, you know, you get your tickets and so forth, and then you begin the climb. So there's another good climb where you are stopping and panting and what have you, gasping for breath if you've been there. It is quite an experience. But when you get off the bus right there at the entrance where you begin the climb, they have restrooms. And so a number of our people needed to go to the restroom first. Well, I was concerned I didn't want to miss the sunrise over the mountains there. I really didn't realize that, because it was already light. I thought, oh, we're going to miss it. And so I left the rest of the people, left the group with the guide, and said, I'll meet you at the viewpoint we were at yesterday afternoon. And so I didn't realize that even though it was light out, sunrise was still, you know, like an hour away to come up over the mountains. But I took off, and I'm motoring, and I'm passing people that are in their 30s and 40s, and I'm proud. And then when they can't see, I stop and start panting and get my breath. A little ego in that. But anyway, what the story I want to tell you is, you can't see out. As you're walking and making the climb, there's brush and trees and so forth, and it's a tough, steep climb, and so I took a wrong turn. There was a little sign that said to High Point or something, and I thought that's where maybe we had been. I didn't pay attention in the afternoon when we went, so I took it, and I ended up having to climb way higher, and got to the highest point of Machu Picchu that you could possibly view it. And then I started, at that point, realizing, you know, sunrise wasn't going to happen right now, and I began to look for the rest of my group. Well, I got lost because there is a maze through there, and I couldn't find my way back to them, to that viewpoint that we had been together. And so it was over an hour later that I finally found them. And so I experienced the sunrise on my own, but I was traveling and hiking and hit some high places, and I came to, and fortunately it was like I got to be in places all alone where there weren't a lot of other people or anything, and I got to pause and stop and soak it in and feel, and there was one place in particular where it was a spiritual highlands moment, you know, where I just felt one with the earth, with the mountains, with everything. I felt being loved. It was just incredible energy. It was one of those moments that you take with you in your life. And the next slide actually shows it, because you might go to the next slide. There you go. So the sun on the right, I think it's the right, yeah, was peeking through the clouds, and I was seemingly above the clouds, and I was in this unique place, and I had been there alone for a time, and then a couple people came along, and I asked them to take a photo. And that's how I got that photo. But that was a magical moment in the spiritual highlands for me that I took with me. And so we have to be realistic and understand that also you can't stay on the mountaintop. You know, we have mountaintop moments. But basically you have to come down, and you can't maintain that intensity forever. Even Jesus and Moses had mountaintop experiences and had to come down and do their work, right? Okay, and I'm not likening myself to Moses or Jesus, please. But I'm just saying. But those moments you take with you, okay? So they went to the mountain because there was something that happened and there was an energy that they embraced and they took it with them, even as they were working the work that they had to do. And so you've all had moments like that, and you need to remember. It stays with you. You recall it. You revisit it. It becomes your friend. And we don't have to go to a Machu Picchu to be able to have that high moment, okay? That, I'm just telling you, one of mine was there to remind you of yours, actually. And so it can happen in a meditation. It can happen in a profound demonstration of truth or a manifestation or a healing or an exchange of deep, deep love with another person or with a group or whatever, just love. It can be a sunrise. It can be a sunset. It can be something beautiful, but something happens, and it takes you to a new spiritual highland, you know? And it's a beautiful thing. And it's something that is received at a deep level because we've opened up to it. And there is presence in it. There's always presence in it. And it's expansive. So, you know, there's a story about a rather enlightened woman who was traveling through the mountains herself and connecting to her source. And she happened to find in the stream a precious stone, very valuable. Well, the next day, as experiences would have it, she met up with another traveler, and the traveler was out of food and needed food, asked, and was hungry. And so she opened her bag, and when she opened her bag to get the food out, he saw this precious stone, this traveler. And he was audacious enough to say, "Would you give me that stone?" And she, without hesitation, took the stone and gave it to this traveler. And he went away rejoicing because he knew that he would have security forever, the rest of his life. It was so valuable. But interestingly enough, a day later, he sought her out and found her again. And he came to her and to this wise woman, and he said, "You know, I've been thinking. I know how valuable this stone is. But I give it back in the hope that you can give me something even more precious. Give me what it is that you have within you that enabled you to give me that stone so swiftly and without hesitation." And you see, again, it's back to, you know, there are things that are happening. We live in a physical material world, but really what we want and have a desire for is a feeling of connection. And this traveler, in the story really, was recognizing that something more precious than anything I could ever have or carry with me is a feeling of connectedness, and I want what you had. I want to have that. So we are all that traveler. All of us are that traveler, you know. And we're all asking to be given this feeling of connectedness at a deep level, to connect with a wisdom and a truth that energetically puts us above the world, so to speak, in all its challenges, whatever they may be. It calls for, you know, with all the challenges that we're facing in the world right now, and every time and era has had them, things to be afraid of, and, you know, now it's been COVID and climate change and droughts and fires and guns and all the political stuff that's going on. It certainly calls for and signals to us a deeper need to go to a new depth of knowing the truth and having faith so we don't get gobbled up by all that. This is coming at us hard and fast and from every direction. There is a stream of God presence. There's a stream of God presence that is flowing through you, okay? Through every one of us. And we can become more sensitive to that stream of knowing simply by becoming more sensitive to knowing when we're in it, because we're feeling and have an awareness of the energies, and we can become sensitive and aware when we're out of it. We know that, isn't it? We feel really kind of separate. But this idea of a stream, I love the 46th Psalm, and some of you will know and recognize the words from the 46th Psalm, but it goes like this: God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And it goes on to say, therefore, we will not fear, though the earth could change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult, though the fires burn through California and the Midwest, whatever, you know. The next line, however, says, there is a river. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. There's that Most High again. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. I love that. I love that. It speaks to our times, any times, really, when all our world and all the circumstances and all the things external to us are being shaken up and in tumultuousness, you see. But there's a river whose streams make glad the city of God. You're the city of God. You are the habitation of the Most High. That's what you are. And God is in the midst of her. And she shall not be moved. It's not ever going to leave you. It'll always be with you. You have to engage with it. So never forget that. There is that river running through you. Also in the 46th Psalm, the same Psalm is where you find that statement, be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. A statement that's saying, I'm streaming, I'm the river running through you. I am. I am. Okay? So we all battle this disconnect, the sense of separation. The ego wants to take us there oftentimes into fear, anger, judgment, what have you. You know, a lot of people think that enlightenment and spiritual growth is somehow going to allow us to avoid dealing with those things that are uncomfortable. You know, some people think it's really the escape, so I'm going to get spiritual because I'll escape all this stuff. And, you know, if I get enlightenment, man, my life will be perfect. I'll have the perfect life, I'll have the perfect mate, I'll have the perfect job, I'll have the perfect. And it isn't that way. A big realization for you to come to is that even people of very high consciousness still have stress and fear, judgments, imperfect thoughts. They come, but the difference is the recovery is quick. The recovery is quick because we live in a thought soup, okay? And they're coming in and they're flowing and you have to be able to block and jump back in the stream or the river that's vibrating high. And they notice. They have a sense of noticing when these things are going on. And therefore, each moment becomes really an experience of an invitation. You're being invited in those high moments to open up to them, to feel them, to embrace them, to know that God is there with you in them, to be absorbed and embraced. And then the low moments are those where you're invited, it's another invitation, to wake up and to notice, you know, that you need to climb up and out of there, to climb to a higher place in consciousness in that moment. Because your body and your feeling nature is always sending you signals as to where you are, okay? And that's the beauty, because we have all this help. So there's this willingness to inquire within our body and to really see our thoughts as well. So, you know, even knowledge, there's mental knowledge and there's spiritual knowledge, and mental knowledge is looking at things pretty much things externally, and we're judging them, we're comparing them, we're analyzing, we're weighing, we're measuring, we're doing all that. But to know something spiritual, you have to become it. You have to be one with it, you see? It is a feeling, and it is beyond the faculty of the mind. The mind cannot take you there, okay? It may steer you, but basically it's your heart that opens. Your heart opens. And a feeling comes rushing in of connectedness to it all. And so it is always this kind of a spiritual Highlands moment is always beyond mind. Mind will shut it down. Mind will take you back to, oh, measuring it. Isn't this great? Isn't that wonderful? You know, last year I was at a place that it was almost as pretty as this, or whatever. But the mind will want to get into a narrative. So, another thing that's important. is that I think a Highlands moment always brings you a expanded sense of self. It's like I was just Howard climbing, trying to find the group. Okay, just Joe Howard, the climber. And then I was able to pause and be quiet and be embraced by that, the place I was being surrounded with. And in that moment, I was expanded beyond myself. You know, there's a song that has come to me since that I reflect on about that. When I go back to that place, and it just came flowing in. It's the song, One Moment in Time. You were hearing it being sung. And there's a couple lines from that that just jumped out at me, you know, that is, I just love. Now I can't think of it, but it's in, I want one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be. And then in that moment in time, I will be with one with eternity, something like that. And then the next line is, give me one moment in time when I'm racing with destiny. And then in that one moment of time, I will be free. Okay? And so I can't get those lyrics out of my mind, especially the one, I want one moment in time, you know, when I'm one with eternity. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. So anyway, on this whole idea of connecting with spirit, a word that has come to me that is very significant is the word here. You know, we talk about, you know, God is here now or being here now, but the word here has become bigger for me. And I say over and over the word, God is here. God is here. God is here. Because then I start feeling the energy. It's here. It's not, I don't need the word now. That's fine. Put the word now there. I don't take that away from anyone. But it's kind of like anywhere I am, anywhere I go, the truth is I'm here. I'm here. And the truth is, where's God? God is here. And so somehow for me, that word here has become bigger, bigger and more expansive. I don't know if it can be of help to you. But you know, there is a book called The Story of Unity, and it's by James Dillard Freeman. And James Dillard Freeman in that book says that there was a single most popular thing that was ever published by Unity. The single most popular thing ever published by Unity. And it was the prayer of faith. And some of you know that prayer of faith. And the prayer of faith goes like this. God is my help in every need. God does my every hunger feed. God walks beside me, guides my way through every moment of the day. I now am wise. I now am true, patient, kind, and loving too. All things I am can do and be through Christ, the truth that is in me. God is my health. I can't be sick. God is my strength, unfailing, quick. God is my all. I know no fear for God and love and Christ are here. And so I leave with you the idea that God is here. God's been with us the whole time. God has always been with you. The stream, the river is running through you. And I invite you at this moment just to join me in saying, God is here. Together? God is here. Again, God is here. Three is a charm. God is here. Thank you very much. Thank you for allowing me to be here. And so now we have come to the moment to really share our gratitude with offering time, and let's anchor in and express the true prosperity. And let's say together our statement, okay? Divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God. And dear God, we give thanks in knowing the truth that you are here always, the stream, the river that flows through us. And so it is. Amen. So Now's the time where we joyfully share our individual abundance with the community. This community gives you so much. And for those watching on Facebook, YouTube, we hope that you'll consider also supporting this ministry, Unity Bay Area Houston, through online donation. It can be done text or online or a check in the mail. And we thank you for those of you who are moving and acting on that. And our ushers are already here accepting and receiving the gifts. And we thank you for your support. And I thank you for the opportunity to be with you.
Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest day is yet unknown. I broke my heart for every gain. To taste the sweet, I face the pain. I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains.
Patty Rabaza. So now, let's affirm together. We celebrate divine abundance. We gratefully live, breathe, and experience abundance and generosity. Thank you, God, for the flow of resources through our ministry to bless the world. We rejoice as all our prayers are answered. We are grateful, blessed, and prosperous. Yes, we are. So here's my little quick thing. It's 8 weeks, 8 weeks, 8 weeks, 8 weeks till our next garage sale. Miss Sarah wanted me to let y'all know. You know, I'm going to tell you about it every week. There is a sign-up sheet if you'd like to go ahead and sign up to be on the team. We'll have more information, of course, as we go along. But what Miss Sarah would really like for you to do is to start putting your things aside, putting things away, getting ready for the abundance. It's time for our abundance practice, y'all. So thank you very much. Please get excited. It is October 1st. Next. Thank you. And our prayer circle, just a reminder, we're having a prayer circle right after the service with John V. and Sarah. And? Patty, take us out.
You bet. You guys want to stand up and sing this with me?
together. The light of God surrounds us. I am the light of God. The love of God unfolds us. I am the love of God. The power of God protects us. I am the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence of God. Wherever I am, God is, and all is well. And we thank you, Reverend Howard, for being with us, and we say, yay, God!